Hello everyone, welcome back to Vintage. Hello, new subscribers who came over from Jen's channel after last week's collaboration video. It's very lovely to meet you all. Thank you for the amazing comments that we've had for the giveaway. Lots of you very enthusiastic about a full range of books, including one that I didn't actually mean to include in the giveaway, but never mind, we'll find a copy from somewhere. But lovely to have you all here. Please do stick around. I'm here every Friday talking about the book or books that have got me really, really excited at Vintage in that week, or sometimes talking about books that are outside Vintage. And in fact, that's what I'm going to be doing today. I'm doing a gigantic pre-Christmas non-Vintage book haul. So a great big collection of books that I'm hoping to read over Christmas in a very optimistic fashion. But before we do that, I need to talk about who won books in the previous vlog. A couple of weeks ago, I was talking about A Horse Walks Into a Bar by David Grossman. I had two copies to give away, and Bald Book Geek and Angel Exit Theatre are the winners of those. You will find my email address at the bottom of this video's description. Send me your postal addresses and I'll get copies of that book off to you as soon as I can. There is still time to enter the giveaway for the American Classics. If you don't know what I'm talking about, follow this link and you'll watch the video on Jen's channel and then come back here and make sure you leave a comment on the video which I did with Jen about poetry. You've got one day left because I said we'd do it until the 10th. So I'll pick winners tomorrow and then you'll be notified somehow, somewhere, and hopefully get books to you before Christmas. Anyway, that's the preamble. Let's talk about this gigantic pile of books that I've got here. Now, as I say, it's optimistic, but basically, obviously, through the year, a lot of my reading is dominated by books here at Vintage, and occasionally I get to sort of read something from outside the building. I particularly get to do that when I'm on holidays, and we've got a holiday coming up, haven't we, with Christmas. Obviously, Christmas is a bit busy, so I don't know how much reading I'll actually get done, but I have this big pile of books, and I would love it if I could read at least some, if not all of them. And what I'll do is I'll just quickly whip through them all and tell you what they are and why I've picked them. Sound good? First up, this is Pond by Claire Louise Bennett, which is published by Fitzcarraldo Editions. And I've just heard too many good things about this collection. It's a collection of stories, but they're all narrated by the same person. So you could argue that it's a novel, but it's sort of billed as a collection of stories. And as I say, I've just heard amazing things about the quality of the writing. Fitzcarraldo Editions make these beautiful books which are either blue or white covers, so they look lovely on your shelf if you're into collecting books, because you can either go blue, 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 white, white, or you can go blue, white, blue, white, blue, white. Anyway, you know what I'm talking about. So I'm very excited to read these. I'm trying to read more short stories, and these sound like they might be fantastic. So that's that one. Next up, we have The Evenings by Gerard Reeve. So this is from Pushkin Press. As you can see, it's got this beautiful, beautiful jacket. And I was particularly intrigued by this for two reasons. One, it's very much being billed as a sort of one of the most popular books in Holland, finally getting its English translation. I think there was a poll recently and it came top of this poll. So it's obviously a hugely important book in the Netherlands. So I'm intrigued to read it for that reason. But also, it seems to be set in the period between Christmas and New Year. How good is that to read a book sort of in the period that you're going through? I love the idea of doing that. So I, for that reason alone, it would have been on my list. But I think the huge praise in its homeland and this beautiful cover make it a complete shoo-in for me. So there you go. That's The Evenings by Gerard Reeve, published by Pushkin Press. Now, up here we have I Am No One by Patrick Flannery. And the reason why I've picked this up is because I've read a couple of Patrick's other books and I've really enjoyed them both. I think he's quite an interesting writer. You may not have heard of him before. He's just sort of getting on with it and writing these novels, which are published by Atlantic. And I'm quite a loyal reader. So if a writer has sort of intrigued me or kind of got me enough, I will stick with them and I want to keep reading what they do because I want to see how they progress and develop. So in fact, this has been on my sort of TBR pile for quite a long part of this year, but I'm hoping that I will actually get to it now over Christmas. So there you go. I Am No One by Patrick Flannery, which is published by Atlantic. It says here, you want to know a little bit about what these books are about, don't you? So Jeremy O'Keefe, a middle-aged professor of history, returns to his native New York after a decade teaching at Oxford, hoping to reconnect with his daughter and rebuild the life he left behind. He settles into the rhythm of long evenings spent alone after days teaching students he barely knows. Then a strange encounter with a young man who presumes an acquaintance Jeremy cannot remember, and a series of disconcerting events leave him with a growing conviction that he is being watched. I'm going to stop there, because this is what Patrick Flannery does. He does it, you know, he gives you enough to kind of go, ooh, ooh, that sounds interesting. So it seems to be all about obsession, fear, paranoia. Sounds good, doesn't it? Anyway, that's that. Next up on my list, here we have The Good Immigrant, which is this collection of essays and writing, which was edited by Nikesh Shukla, and it was published by Unbound. A fantastic campaign to get this book published, and I've been very pleased to sort of be a very small part of that as somebody who sort of, you know, paid money to Unbound to help make sure the book got published. They didn't need me, of course. They had J.K. Rowling saying that she would put up $5,000 or whatever it was to help it get published. But a very important and timely collection of essays. I've had the good fortune to meet some of the people who've written them. I have actually made a start on this, and I'm just hoping to get the chance to finish it over Christmas. But a fantastic book. It's great to see that it's done really well. It's been winning prizes and awards from readers, which shows that there is an appetite for this kind of publishing. If the argument has been in the past that, you know, that there isn't an appetite for it, or that the writers in this collection don't exist, the BAME experience in the UK is just, you know, the light of that has been shown, because this book has been phenomenally successful. And I'm very proud to be, you know, a very, very small part of it. So there you go. That is The Good Immigrant from Unbound. Next we have All We Shall Know by Donal Ryan. The reason why I've picked this up is because I read a review by John Burnside, one of my favourite writers, in the paper, and he does this to me. It's really annoying. He writes amazing reviews that immediately make you go, I have to read that book. Even though, I mean, I know Donal Ryan, I've never read any of his stuff before, but, you know, as I say, when Burnside gives his praise to something, he often writes his review so well, because he writes everything so well, that I just can't resist. So that's why I picked this one up, and I don't know much about it, but I'll tell you here. Melody Shee is alone and in trouble. Her husband doesn't take her news too well. She can't tell her father yet because he's a good man and this could break him. She's trying to stay in the moment, but the future is looming, larger by the day, while the past won't let her go. What she did to Breedy Flynn all those years ago still haunts her. And I won't read any more of the blurb, because again, I think that's probably enough to give you a hook. So that is All We Shall Know by Donal Ryan. Non-fiction now. Yeah, I could do non-fiction too. This is Blitzed by Norman Ohler, and this is published by Alan Lane, one of the imprints of Penguin. And it's about drugs in Nazi Germany, as you can tell from this subtitle. Basically, the idea behind this book is that through meticulous research, Norman Ohler has discovered that the use of methamphetamines, or speed, was quite widespread in Nazi Germany, not just through the sort of army and air force, but also the civilian population as well, and indeed right up to the top ranks. So in fact, there are sort of three sections of the book looking at the wide use amongst the German population. This is the drug here, Pervitin. This is not exclusively a German thing either. So, you know, the use of barbiturates was quite common in the UK. You may have seen a film called Requiem for a Dream, which is all about sort of drug addiction. And in that, the sort of the mother is addicted to speed. It was sold as a way of controlling appetite, helping to keep you sort of pepped up and able to get through your day's chores. There's an amazing scene where she basically does housework for the whole day. And you see it on a sort of time-lapse camera, because she's just speeding like a crazy person. So there's the section about the civilian population, there's the stuff about the war, which shows why some of the slightly strange decisions that were taken during the course of the Second World War may have been influenced by drug use and policy. And then you get to hear more about Hitler himself, and this is because of looking at the diaries and the notes of his personal physician, who it seems may have been giving him injections of a cocktail of drugs for many, many years. And this in particular is part of the reason they think for his rapid decline towards the end of the Second World War and some of his more bizarre decisions in terms of strategy. There is a huge moral question here, of course, which is, do we have a problem here if we say that there is any kind of abdication of responsibility by talking about drug use? And I think we have to be very careful, obviously, with that question. There's been some, I saw a review that had taken this book to task because of that. So it'll be interesting to see whether this is being used as any kind of explanation for how people behaved, or simply a piece of background information about the cultural things that were going on at the time. So not an explanation of why people behaved, but sort of just a bit more information. But I'm fascinated. So there we go. That's that. Blitzed by Norman Ohler, published by Penguin. Over here we have Solar Bones by Mike McCormack, which was on the prize list this year and has had like amazing, amazing reviews. And it was just after having been battered over the head by another amazing review that I thought, okay, I give in. I've got to read this book. Now, I actually did make a start on this book before Christmas, and I really struggled to get into it and to stay into it. And the reason for that is because it is written as a kind of single sentence, really. Or it's not really a single sentence because it is broken up into paragraphs, which are kind of like I'm doing now, where you're having a thought and then, oh, it takes you over there and you go somewhere else and then you come back. And so it's sort of, it's not punctuated like a sentence. There is no full stop. But really what you're getting is sort of coherent paragraphs, which are one thought leading onto another, onto another. I think that if I can give myself the time and the space to read this, that it could be fantastic. And as I say, so many people have given this book amazing reviews. They must be right. I mean, they might not be, but I think they probably will. So there we go. Mike McCormack's Solar Bones, which is published by Tramp Press, a small independent press, and it's great to see them obviously doing a great job with this book. How you doing? Three more?
Yeah.
Okay. Amor Towles, A Gentleman in Moscow. This is a proof that I picked up. I actually found it lying around somewhere here. And it's because I read his debut novel, The Rules of Civility, many, many years ago. And I absolutely loved that book. It was so much fun. It was set in 1920s New York, started off at New Year's Eve. You met this amazing woman called Katie Content, who I completely fell in love with. If you've watched the first anniversary video that I did for the first birthday of the vlog, I talk about it in that video. We were asking about if you've ever actually fallen in love with a character. And I think that's one of these things that people say, but they never actually have done. I love Katie Content. I know she's not real, but she's mine. And that is obviously quite a skillful thing for a writer to be able to do. I can't think of it ever happening to me in the past. So that's why I'm intrigued to know a bit more about what he's going to write next. This is quite a big book, though. So I think of all the books that I've got here, this is probably the one that's least likely to get read, because I'm just going to keep picking it up and going, oh, blimey, that's big. But as you can tell, we've got, again, another sort of 1920s feel to this book from the design, and clearly set in Moscow, I'm guessing. The blurb on the back here says, Count Alexander Rostov, recipient of the Order of St. Andrew, member of the Jockey Club, master of the hunt, is escorted out of the Kremlin, across Red Square, and through the elegant revolving doors of the Hotel Metropole. But instead of being taken to his usual suite, he is led to an attic room with a window the size of a chessboard. Deemed an unrepentant aristocrat by a Bolshevik tribunal, the Count has been sentenced to house arrest indefinitely. And the little blurb at the bottom there says, a life without luxury can be the richest of all. Wonder what that means. You will discover in 450 pages. So anyway, that is Amor Towles, A Gentleman in Moscow, which is published by Hutchinson. I knew that. Penultimate book here on my pile, Swing Time by Zadie Smith, which is published by Hamish Hamilton. I don't need to give you a reason why I'm reading this. I'm going to read it because it's Zadie Smith and because she's awesome. And partly as well because it seems to be about dancing in some way, and I have some connection to that in my past, and so I'm intrigued to know how she will write about that. But as I say, this book needs no introduction or explanation. You should read it because it's written by Zadie Smith, and she's awesome. Final book is a graphic novel, The Can Opener's Daughter by Rob Davis, and this is published by Self Made Hero. Rob Davis wrote a novel called The Motherless Oven, which is another graphic novel, which I really enjoyed. And this is a sort of sequel. It's written in the same world. And this is a very, very strange world, because in the first book, it would rain knives. And the people's parents were not people. They were machines, but they were people. It was very, very odd. And I kind of adored it. So I'm really, really intrigued to know where he's going to go with this one. He's taken one of the characters from the first book, and now we're going to get to see a bit more about his story. Just really, really brave writing and sort of amazing imagination that Rob Davis shows. Self-Made Hero, fantastic graphic novel publisher. So if you haven't read any of their stuff, do have a look at their website. There's some great stuff there. This I'm sure I'll get to because it's a graphic novel, so that'll be much easier. So there you go. That's my insanely large pre-Christmas non-vintage book haul video. I'm sorry it was so long, but I hope I've given you a little taste of some of the stuff I'm hoping to read. I will, of course, come back next year and tell you what I thought of some of those books if I've read them. What are you going to be reading over Christmas? Why don't you tell me in the comments below, seeing as I can't give away any books this week. I want to hear what you're reading. I want to hear what you're excited about. Next week, I'll be doing, I think, another classics challenge for December. And then it's suddenly going to be very close to Christmas. And so you might have to wait a couple of weeks before we get into 2017. When we come back, I'll be telling you all about some of the very exciting books that we've got coming up at Vintage in the next year, and the things that I've maybe already read, the things that I'm excited about reading. It'll be like a very exciting preview of 2017, which I am genuinely excited about. There are some amazing books. But I think I've whittled on enough. That's all for now. Thank you, everybody, for watching, and I will see you next week. Take care.